You are now entering the spoiler zone. The following podcast contains explicit plot details and pockets of profanity. You have been warned. The Exton Moss Experiment. Adventures in Wine and Space with Simon Exton and Ken Moss. Hello everyone, and a very warm welcome to another edition of the Exton Moss Experiment. I'm Ken Moss.
I'm Simon Exton.
And tonight we are watching the nine-part BBC series from 1987, Star Cops. Like the ripple on the water, sends a message to the shore, so I know forever after, I will miss you more and more. Set in the year 2027, a time where interplanetary travel has become commonplace, it starred David Calder as Nathan Spring, commander of the International Space Police Force, nicknamed the Star Cops, who provide law enforcement for the newly developing colonies of the solar system. The series follows Nathan Spring and the rest of his multinational team as they work to establish the Star Cops and solve whatever crimes come their way. Send out the word. Let them know what can be. Send out the word. I'll be mad. Well, we've watched all nine episodes of this.
And we have to listen to the theme tune nine times.
Strangely, the first time I heard the theme tune, I thought, what's this? It stinks of the 80s. It does peculiarly grow on you. I still don't think it fits very well, but I can see what they were attempting to do. But we don't want to spoil it too much, because we need a drink first. Time to get out the tonic screwdriver. Tonight we are drinking Batch Distillery Riparian Zone Gin. It's 40%, it's watermelon and mint gin, and the infobollock says, Riparian Zone Gin was inspired by a dream our distiller Ryan had. Taking inspiration from that very dream, he began working on a new method of distilling, and this is an experimental recipe from along the way. Using juicy watermelon and cooling mint, this is a refreshing gin, and is the heart of what we do. Innovation! First things first, we need a sniffette. Neat. Witch hazel.
Ooh, quite sharp. You can get the watermelon. You can definitely get the mint. It's unusual for a batch because they don't normally smell very much.
No.
But this does.
Well, a quick swig at neat.
Oh, weird. Tastes like smoked salmon.
The hell?
It tastes like smoked salmon.
There's a definite smoked edge to it. Yes. What?
I went out for breakfast the other morning because we were heading down to Plymouth, and we went to our local Frankie and Benny's, and the bastards were closed. So we went to the posh restaurant opposite.
Weatherspoons.
Yeah, in your fucking eye. And I wanted Eggs Benedict. They didn't do it, but they did the Salmon Royal Benedict thing. The smoked salmon was absolutely gorgeous. And that reminds me of the taste of that. It's weird. It tastes like smoked salmon.
Well, anyway, mixed with tonic.
Mixed with tonic?
I get the mint. That's the first thing that comes out of the glass.
I'm still smelling smoked salmon, I'm afraid. And well done, Ryan, because I really like smoked salmon. No idea what you were dreaming, but...
Well, eyes down, dive in. I don't know whether now I'm tasting it with my imagination, but I can taste smoked salmon.
I'm still getting the smoked salmon. I really like smoked salmon, so woohoo. But it's odd. Neat. You get the watermelon, you get the mint. Everything else, smoked salmon. It's absolutely delicious, and yeah.
I had no idea what to expect from this, because watermelon and mint are not two flavours that I would mix together. Batch, as ever.
Oh, I would. They work lovely together. Exotic fruit and mint, and particularly if you put them with a little bit of citrus, it's absolutely gorgeous. So do you not remember when you, I mean, it's a good few years ago now, but you came around and I made a fruit salad with strawberry and mint and Grand Marnier.
Yes, of course I do.
Yeah, exotic fruits, so strawberry, watermelon, mango, all of that sort of thing. Bung it in with a bit of mint, bung it in with a bit of orange liqueur. Absolutely delicious. That's kind of what I was expecting from this. It's not what we've got. What we've got is one of the best things that Batch has produced. I think it's absolutely gorgeous, but it's smoked salmon gin. My mum would have necked this and then demanded everybody else's.
Well, it's remarkably appropriate, given that riparian means sort of by the riverbank. So I suppose it's living up to its name. I'm neither getting watermelon nor mint from the taste. I'm certainly getting it from the nasal, but it's a lovely drink.
It's really odd, but lovely. Smoked salmon in a glass. It's absolutely gorgeous.
Bernard?
5. Without a shadow of a doubt, 5.
And it's 4 for me. So yes, thumbs up all round. But glasses in hand, it's time to descend into the bowels of Podcasting House and open up the Black Archive. Dr. Von Goosewing, what are you picking out for us this time?
Don't you sully me with that shite. I was thinking I should go for something moony, but what I'm going to go for is something BBC sci-fi-ish that's missing, and I'm going to go for the last serial that is missing from the BBC archives from the 1960s, and that's Counter-Strike.
Oh, God damn it.
Counter-Strike's a bit slow, but it's quite good.
Oh, it's not. Simon, I fell asleep during
Yes, but it was about 3 o'clock in the morning. You were wankered.
Admittedly, but I've been wankered at 3 o'clock in the morning and not fallen asleep when we've watched stuff.
You didn't give it a fair chance, so we need to do it again.
No!
I think that is a little unfair to it. Counter-Strike was kind of the British answer to The Invaders, the American Roy Thinnes series. And it is the story of an alien by the name of Simon King, or who takes the name of Simon King, who comes to Earth to try and foil the machinations of a different set of aliens, and hooks up with an English doctor, and they have weird adventures together. The pilot, admittedly, is pedestrian and dull. The other 3 surviving episodes are quite interesting. One of them is a remake of a Prisoner episode, and there are 6 missing episodes, one of which was never transmitted. So it's about the rarest of the missing episodes, because it would have been seen by a few dozen people at most and never transmitted. I rather like Counter-Strike. It has its faults. I would be the first to admit that, but it is quite good.
Well, I am sticking with a similar theme. I'm going to go with a series called Target Luna. It was a TV serial broadcast by ABC Weekend TV in 1960, written by Malcolm Hulk and Eric Pace, directed by Adrian Brown, produced by Sidney Newman. It featured Frank Finlay as Conway Henderson and Michael Craze as Jeffrey Wedgwood. And on the back of this, we got 3 sequels: Pathfinders in Space, Pathfinders to Mars, and Pathfinders to Venus.
Pathfinders in Space, we did the first episode in our part 1 series, and you weren't impressed, and we need to see the whole lot because it's great.
Because I forget now what is missing.
Archive wise, it's Target Luna. The other 3 series exist in their entirety.
Oh, yeah, I've got it into my head that one of the Pathfinder series had a gap, but it's Target Luna that's the only one that's got a gap, right?
Well, Target Luna and Plateau of Fear, which is the follow-on with the 2 main cast taking up new roles, and rather than in space doing underwater stuff. And Plateau of Fear is the first one that was live and never recorded. And then there are 2 sequels, which are City Beneath the Sea and Secret Beneath the Sea, both of which exist. And again, are marvellous and will do at some point.
So here we are back in the viewing room. And without further ado, it's Ron VT on all 9 episodes of Star Cops.
I have some news for you. That job with the International Space Police Force. I've just been notified. You're on the shortlist. Congratulations.
Shortlist?
And I shall use all the influence I can muster to ensure that you get that job.
That's very kind of you, sir, but actually I don't want that job.
Yes, you do, Nathan. Of course you do.
I'll withdraw my name straight away.
Not a good idea. A very bad idea, in fact.
Why?
Well, in the first place, you're the only Brit left. It wouldn't look good to pull out before the final adjudication.
Well, I didn't realize it was an event in multimedia sport. Tell me, do I wear a sponsor's logo?
And it carries a rank that you're very unlikely to reach down here. Commander, International Space Police Force. Got a certain ring to it?
A fairly hollow ring given a force of 20 so part-timers, and affectionately termed the Star Cops.
They need someone like you to shake them up.
Somebody who's never left Earth before.
Spacemen are 10 a penny, Nathan. What they need is a good copper.
Fine. Why don't you go up there?
Detective Chief Superintendent Spring, you will not withdraw your name. Assuming, of course, that you wish to continue in your present career.
2027.
Yeah.
4 years' time.
It's the case with a lot of these things. They're a tad optimistic as to what's going to happen in 30 or 40 years' time.
I suppose that was 40 years' time from transmission, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Because I remember watching this on first transmission.
Now, the first thing I'm going to say, I'm going to get it right out of the way because it will save me saying it a billion times over the course of this episode. This would have been so much better done on film. Oh, God damn. This is a wonderful series. I really, really enjoyed this. It's a pity there's only 9 episodes, but it was all done on videotape. Even the bloody effect shot, there's some lovely, lovely model work in it. Some of it's on film, but a lot of it's on videotape. This series screams potential.
Yes, I mean, I see it from a more nostalgic point of view than you do, because I watched it at the time, and I enjoyed it at the time. And I think it was around about the same time as the first series of Red Dwarf, and I preferred this to the first series of Red Dwarf. This was the one I looked forward to rather than Red Dwarf.
Well, you can see an awful lot of similarities, certainly in the sound effects. The control room sound effects in this are the same as the bridge sound effects in Red Dwarf, the first and I think second series. So it's all steeped in, it certainly feels more like Red Dwarf than Doctor Who.
Yes.
But you just look at this thing and the effort that's gone into making it look decent. This series was created by Chris Boucher, who most archive TV fans will probably know best from Doctor Who. He has done a lot of other things, actually, but Doctor Who was probably his best-known thing. So it was his baby, really, this. And it should have been a 10-episode series. There was a 10th episode called Death on the Moon planned, which was a sort of Agatha Christie in space thing. That was never filmed due to strikes at the BBC. So what we're left with is a 9-part series. And it follows the journey of Nathan Spring, who starts out as a police detective sergeant. He's quite high up on Earth.
He was a detective chief inspector because going up to commander on the moon is a promotion for him.
Mm.
And when Theroux gets promoted to his deputy, he becomes detective chief inspector.
It all starts off very, almost straight drama, because you've got his domestic situation with his partner, and that only lasts a couple of episodes, and then it shows his adapting to working in space and the physical effects of working in space. And there's some good attempts at doing weightless scenes, and they drop off quite quickly. Within 3 or 4 episodes, they've more or less given up on those. But there's a real effort here to make this as realistic as possible and not try and just be COD space drama. I really like the approach to this. Graham Harper directed quite a few of these, and it shows.
Yeah, I mean, the thing I hadn't really twigged when I was first watching it, and when you know about it, it's kind of obvious that they had 2 directors who had different approaches to how the moon base should look. So for half the episodes, it's looking quite grimy and run down and quite industrial. And for the other half, it is much spicker and spanner and...
good expression.
Spicker and spanner.
Oh, yes.
But more brightly lit, cleaner and less sort of grimy lines. And that jump between the two, you don't notice it when you're watching it an episode a week. But when you're watching episodes back to back and you know to look out for it, it's there. And it would have been quite nice to have an overarching approach in the way that you'd have now with a showrunner. Whereas then it would have been, I suppose with that, you did have Chris Boucher as a showrunner. But I guess the directors were given a bit more latitude about the way it looked.
Well, to just go through the characters, the principal character is Nathan Spring. He's played by David Calder. And then we've got his second in command, David Theroux, played by Eric Ray Evans. Colin Davis, who comes on board after a few episodes, played by Trevor Cooper. Pal Kenzie, played by Linda Newton, who is an Australian. Anna Shone, who is played by Sayo Inaba, who is a Japanese physician. And Alexander Kravenko, played by Jonathan Adams, who is a Russian commander of the moon base.
And a biochemist as well, I think. That does come in one of the episodes.
They've all got their own particular strengths. And there's a very international feel about it. Everybody's got their flag of origin on the uniform somewhere. Whatever individual countries might think, the whole view of going into space is that it needs to be an international venture. As a group of cops, they're quite dysfunctional. None of them really particularly like each other or get on particularly well. There's quite an affinity between Nathan and David. Early on, they really, really work quite closely together. That drops off almost off a cliff edge a few episodes in, and they work.
Yeah, there's the whole thing where there's a nuclear near miss, and David gets the head staggers, runs off. And it turns out that it's because that's how his father died and he just got freaked. And rather than being on any level sympathetic, it just seems as though he's completely sidelined after that.
Mm.
There seems to be a degree of laddish acceptance between Pal Kenzie and Nathan Spring, and particularly Colin. Although Colin does seem to just expect everybody to conform to his stereotypes or not have anything to do with him. And Anna Shone is fairly pointless. I can understand where they're going with the multinational, bringing different skill sets across, but she has a whole episode to introduce herself. And it's episode 6, so it's over halfway through the series before they introduce her as a regular character. She's introduced as a bit naive, but a conscientious doctor. And then for the remaining episodes, is given no doctoring to do.
Mm.
Oh, no, that's not fair. In the disaster movie episode, she's given a broken arm to fix or something like that. I did like the way that they build the team. It had a real modern TV feeling to it, where you're introducing characters and characters that you think are likely to end up as regulars get bumped off pretty quickly. So Nathan's girlfriend, which was his anchor back to the Earth, gets killed off very quickly. Whereas Anna, who turns out to be a regular character, gets introduced in episode 6. So that kind of evolution of characters, I think, worked very well and had a very modern feel to it. And as I said, had it gone on to series 2, and there are a lot of plans for it to go on to series 2 that never really materialized, there was going to be a shift to some of the action taking place on Mars. And one of the main characters was going to translate across to Mars. And Big Finish, when they came on to do their audio versions of it, which are excellent, by the way, go on to set their second series in Mars.
We'll come on to Big Finish later on, because that is well worth a mention. The production of the TV series, though, was troubled right from the start. Originally, this was pitched as a radio series in the early 80s, but it clashed with Earth Search, written by
James Follett.
James Follett, that's the one. Chris Boucher, he worked on all four series of Blake 7. He then pitched it to Jonathan Powell as a TV series, and that's how it got there. But it was a struggle route because he was also script editing on Bergerac at the time, and he couldn't work on both. But when production was finally greenlit on Star Cops on television, the producer, Boucher and Gridniff, they clashed over how the series was going to be portrayed on screen, and the producer wanted all the scripts rewritten from the ground up. So that didn't go down well. And Chris Boucher, he wanted to write the whole thing himself. And because of the timescales involved and because of the strike that was looming and the problems at the BBC, he could only write half of it. I can't remember who the other writer was, but Philip Martin, he certainly wrote 2 or 3 episodes. I know him best as Doctor Who, Vengeance on Varos and Trial of a Time Lord, but he did do something in the 70s. It was a really, I can't remember the name of the...
Wasn't it Gangsters?
Gangsters, that's the one, yes. Which I've only seen fragments of, but it was a really uncomfortable watch. Have you seen that?
Yeah, it's marvellous.
The series itself has bags of potential. It's just let down by not having the production values that film would have given it. I think film would have smoothed over a lot of the rough edges that video just highlights. Apart from anything else, I'm fairly convinced this was done on 1-inch videotape, because it's the same sort of grain that you get from the Sylvester McCoy Doctor Who's. It's nowhere near as sharp as the Pertwee Tom Baker era stuff that was done on 2-inch videotape.
And you're right. And I think with something like this, it would work better on film. A lot of the time, I don't agree with you on this. I think it has an archive feel to it. But I think something like this probably would work better. But looking at it nostalgically, it has a real look and feel of the time about it. And, you know, you could have the crispest video in the world. Your sets are still going to look straight out of the mid-80s.
True, but the BBC bought up all the sets from Alien in the early 80s, and they were recycled on a lot of productions. You can spot a lot of Alien set on Terminus, and there's a lot of Alien bits and pieces on this as well. So it's not so much that they were bad sets, or even that they were badly put together, because I actually think that some of these sets were really nicely done. It's just that on video, all the flaws, all the rough edges are highlighted. They're there writ large, whereas film, it masks a lot of it. On another technical point, there's the music. Now, they got Justin Hayward to do the theme song for the series.
It won't be easy.
In fact, him and Tony DeConti actually did the incidental music for every episode. Now, at the time, these were big names in music. These were not small beer.
At the time, these had been big names. I mean, Justin Hayward was the Moody Blues, wasn't he?
I think so. I know him best from War of the Worlds.
Yeah, the Moody Blues was not a big name in the 80s. It'd been a big name in the 60s. That was a while beforehand.
My musical knowledge isn't great, I've got to be honest, but I recognise the names as big hitters. The problem is, it doesn't really fit. And I'm going to skip very slightly ahead because it's a good excuse to use it. The Big Finish version, the theme tune that they came up with for Stark Ops, that is a proper theme. I have had that in my head for weeks prepping for this episode. I've heard some of the Stark Ops Big Finish stuff. I think it's all universally wonderful. I think that they've taken elements of the TV series, run with it, and gone in a direction that I think the TV series would have loved to have gone.
Yeah, it was really the first big thing that Big Finish did that kicked against the Big Finish effect. So the whole, we have our regulars who are brought back and are absolutely inviolable and don't change at all from the way they were in the TV series. And we have a villain within the group who is somebody that they all trust and is revealed in the last episode to be a traitor and is not one of the original people, but it is somebody who is related to the original people. And that happened in UNIT, and that happened in the Omega Factor, and that happened in all sorts of different places. And somebody obviously recognized that they had standard Big Finish plot number one, which people were seeing a mile away. And they played up to it. And there was one of the new regular characters in the first couple of series of Stark Ops who was set up to be the Big Finish effect bad guy pulling the strings behind the scenes, who turned out to be every bit as innocent as she appeared and a complete victim. And it was a real breath of fresh air. And it was obviously somebody who had taken the writer to one side and said, for fuck's sake, have a bit of imagination. Look at TV series and see how this is actually done.
Well, I wasn't going to talk about Big Finish or the Big Finish version as early as we are, but we're on to it.
Except you did.
I know, I did. I couldn't. It was more the theme tune. I bloody love that theme. And I overlaid it.
It's much better. I wish they hadn't used it.
Well, I overlaid it on the titles just as an experiment to see how it looks. And it works perfectly with the TV titles. Oh, God, it really works. Anyway, just as a brief thought on the Big Finish series, there's 2 points. One, if you like Stark Ops, if there are any fans out there that have not heard the Big Finish audios, go and buy them. You will not be disappointed. If nothing else, they're great bits of audio drama. I think they stand alone just as themselves. You don't need any prior knowledge of the TV series because I heard those first. I think I'd seen one or two of the episodes with you randomly. But Stark Ops just works on its own as an audio drama, so that's brilliant. The other thing is, the love, the clear love that the cast have got for being back on something that they loved first time around. It's clear that nobody has just turned up to phone this in because they really loved being in the TV series.
Okay, alumni.
Oh, yes. Who was in this thing?
Well, because there are loads of them across all the episodes, and they're all reasonably forgettable with the occasional exception. I've just focused on the regulars.
Okay.
Would it surprise you to learn that the regular actors, Eric Ray Evans and Sayo Inaba, this was their only major role and each only had a handful of other credits?
Well, call me surprised.
Linda Newton seemed to have done a lot of stuff in Australia, like Country Practice and The Flying Doctors. But because I don't really know Australian television very well, most of what she did didn't really ring a bell. But she did have quite a lot of credits and she was a regular on a couple of other series. So she had a reasonable career. David Calder had a pretty extensive career, was very well known as a guest actor on an awful lot of series and was in Utopia, the Stephen Gallagher series Chimera, in Sleepers. He was a regular on Coronation Street in the 70s and appeared in the film The World Is Not Enough. Trevor Cooper was again in loads and loads and loads of things. Recently has appeared in The Windsors, was in the 1989 version of The Woman in Black, and of course was Friar Tuck in Robot of Sherwood and Takis in Revelation of the Daleks. And finally, Jonathan Adams was in millions of things, but most notably, Dr. Everett Scott in the Rocky Horror Picture Show. All the rest of them were sort of 80s bit part actors. There was the occasional name. Murray Watson turned up. Roy Holder, Jeffrey Baildon, Maggie Oleronshaw. Why do I recognise that name?
She was Davis's wife.
Yeah, I know who she played in this. Why do I recognise the name?
Well, she was in Open All Hours. I think she was in either House of Elliot or something like that.
Well, Stuart Guidotti was in it in an episode from Pathfinders in Space and Secret Beneath the Sea. Robert Jezik.
Yeah, I was surprised to find that. Because he does Frobisher or a million other voices in The Big Finish. But that was a good 15 years after this. So I didn't realize he'd been around that long.
Oh, and do you know who the production manager on three of the episodes was?
I do, because it leapt out at me. It was Gary Downey.
It was Gary Downey. I hadn't realized he'd had a career outside of Doctor Who. And yeah.
Are you speechless?
I'm choosing to be tactful.
Alert, alert. Who's the real Dr. Exton?
Tara Ward was married to Ray Lonnan, still acting in 2020.
Not familiar. Who was she?
She was Preston in...
Oh, yes, she played the sort of the Queen Bee. I can't remember her name. But I was amazed to find that she'd been in Warriors of the Deep as that completely forgettable character.
Yes, I think it's an enthusiastic description of what she did on screen to say she played a part.
In Warriors of the Deep, I hasten to add, she was quite good in Stark Ops.
Well, she didn't do very much. She was a shuttle hostess in the first episode.
Oh, I'm thinking of a different one. Because there was somebody else in Warriors of the Deep. She was that big High Empress. Real striking woman.
Oh, yes.
Jupiter to death. And she was in Warriors of the Deep as well.
I'd forgotten that she was in Warriors of the Deep. Oh, she was in Berlin Station. I hadn't realised that.
Not familiar with it.
Oh, it's fantastic. Berlin Station is really good. Noel's House Party, less so. Waiting for God. Preston in Doctor Who. Not been in an awful lot.
But she was quite good in this.
Nathan, Colin, fantastically portrayed. Pal Kensit is awful. She chews the scenery mercilessly. She has zero emotional range. She is not a good actress, and she is not a good actress on audio, although she has obviously taken some acting lessons in the meantime.
And Anna Shoon, the Sue Tai of Stark Ops.
I think that's a little unfair. I don't think that's down to performance. I think that is down to writing, because she is obviously written as you are Japanese and therefore inscrutable and therefore dull as ditch water, and we're going to write you as such. Of all of the characters, they have no idea what to do with her. You're a rookie, so you're a bit crap, so you won't notice when hardened criminals are gassing you or whatever, and we're not going to give you any medical stuff to do, so actually you're going to be very background and kind of the butt of people's jokes. And the only time that she really does anything interesting is when she's trading insults with Colin. Those are generally quite nice scenes.
Oh, I still don't think she's a very good actress. No, it's clear that English is not her first language.
I think it's writing rather than acting, whereas I think Pal Kensit is a very well-written and very potentially engaging character who is just played with a pile driver. And yeah, she's supposed to be Australian, blah, 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 blah. I just don't think she's a very good actress. And I don't think David Theroux, whoever plays him, is a particularly good actor either.
No, but the character's very likeable. I was very fond of David Theroux. In fact, Eric Ray Evans, who played him, died before Big Finish got their license to do this. And I think it's a shame, because I think that Big Finish would have taken those two characters and run with them. Don't get me wrong, Trevor Coupe, he becomes very much the second character in the Big Finish audios. And does a very good job of it, as far as I can remember. It's been a while since I've listened to any of them. All the others, you know, they're there and they're fleshed out. And I've got to give Big Finish their dues on this. They do flesh characters out that were maybe a little underserved on television. But I do think it's a terrible shame that Eric Ray Evans died before they started. Because he kind of been a very old man. I've not looked into why he died, but in fact, the Oracle's open in front of me. Shall we find out?
Yeah, and his role went to Philip Oliver, who is a superb actor.
Wow, he died very young. 1999 he died. And the reason he wasn't in the last episode of Star Cops, he contracted shingles. I was wondering that. We haven't really talked about the episodes themselves. What did you think?
I really enjoyed this. I mean, I know we've talked an awful lot around the houses in terms of the Big Finish spin-off and technical aspects to it, but I really enjoyed it at the time. I've really enjoyed it every time I've rewatched it. Yes, it looks horrendously 80s. And I hadn't really twigged until it was pointed out just how different the setups look between the two main directors, one going for a more sort of grimy industrial look and one going for a very polished science fiction look. And once that's pointed out to you, then it does stand out. Even for a show with just 9 episodes, there are some themes running across it. So bioterrorism was a big theme.
Yes, it was. That cropped up a couple of times, didn't it? But I still stand by this. I think it's a good series, let down by the production values. And if the BBC had adopted the same principles of drama for this as they did for other things, I think it would be more fondly remembered. I actually think it would be better received at the time, but it was clear that it was a source of embarrassment that had somehow found its way onto the screen. Because there's an interview with Chris Boucher on one of the discs, and I know that you're not particularly interested in that sort of thing, but I listened to it and I listened to where he'd come from. He started out as a gas fitter for Calor and was laid off and decided to have a crack at writing in the 70s, and that's how he worked his way up through Doctor Who, and on the back of a Doctor Who producer got the Star Cops gig. But it was quite obvious that it wasn't really viewed within the BBC as a prestigious thing. It was just an experiment, which is a shame because he speaks so fondly of it as the thing that he is most proud of above Doctor Who. And it's understandable.
Yeah, and I really enjoyed it at the time. I've enjoyed it every time I've watched it since. I think it was around about the same time as Red Dwarf was first
almost
started.
Exactly, yeah. And there's a lot of the sound effects and sets, actually, that you can cross-pollinate between the two.
And of the two, I much preferred this to Red Dwarf.
I can see why. I'm quite a fan of those early Red Dwarfs. And for a rewatch value, I would prefer Red Dwarf. However, in terms of a science fiction drama, the chalk and cheese, because Red Dwarf's a sitcom, but this I would happily have sat through more of. I just didn't see it at the time. It was entirely the wrong time slot for me. At the time I was 8, 9. I was getting tucked up in bed by the time this was starting.
Yeah, whereas I was 18 and already going out to work. I remember watching Red Dwarf and watching Star Cops at the time, and obviously pre-video, I wasn't going to be able to re-watch either of them. But of the two, the one that I used to look forward to was Star Cops. Now, years later, the one that I have gone back to more often is Red Dwarf. And I did like Red Dwarf, just I preferred this. And the week that we're recording this, it's been announced that there's going to be a further Big Finish audio Star Cops. I thought it had died a death after the two series, but I'm delighted to hear they're going to be taking it further.
I must admit, it was a lovely surprise. I think it dropped on the day of recording or yesterday. And the coincidence, because I'd not heard a thing about it, but it is easily one of their best things. So, yeah, I'm quite looking forward to that. More Star Cops.
Yes, definitely. Well, we haven't talked about any of the episode or the TV series itself.
Well, I suppose we haven't. We should probably go through it episode by episode.
Oh, God, do I need an episode list?
No, you don't. You don't. Taking this in order, because there are only 9 episodes. Episode 1 was An Instinct for Murder. And that was first transmitted on the 6th of July, 1987, in a terrible, terrible time slot. I mean, I think this contributes to why the ratings were so comparatively low. 8:30 till 9:20. Who the bloody hell was watching telly at that point on a Monday night?
I was.
Well, yes, all right, but what a death slot. That's just not a natural time for a 50-minute programme at all. 9:00, yep. 8:00, yep. What on earth were they thinking? It was so clear they wanted this to fail. An Instinct for Murder, this is where it all starts. The plot, taken from The Oracle, reluctantly reassigned from a case involving a mysterious drowning, Chief Inspector Nathan Spring, shortlisted for the post of Commander of the International Space Police Force, becomes embroiled in the investigations of a series of unexplained spacesuit failures on the space station Charles de Gaulle. It's very much a setup episode. The one thing I did like about it was it didn't just, right, you're a cop on Earth, now you're a cop in space. Right, fair enough, I'll just adapt my police forcing to space with no ill and all the ill effects of transferring to a zero gravity environment. They are played out on screen. I did like that bit.
Yes, I mean, it is slightly odd in that you get the whole, we're going to have this character who is pointing out the problems with relying on computers in terms of solving crime, and you need to follow instincts, and this murder has been deliberately designed to confuse the computers into thinking it's an accidental drowning when it wasn't. But he spends his life relying on this computer, to PDA the size of a brick in his hand.
Called Box.
But it starts off as a, I don't rely on computers, but, oh, look, I have this magic tricorder that is going to give me all the answers.
There is an element of that, and it's all the way through Box is his constant companion, particularly after, in the second episode, Conversations with the Dead, his girlfriend is murdered. Now, I've got to say, I didn't see that coming. I thought Lee Jones would have been a constant sort of anchor to Earth. And in retrospect, I think it was a good idea killing her off.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, I expected her to be the reason that there's still a pull back home and gradually distancing themselves and ultimately the whole tearful, this isn't going to work. And either she comes up to the moon and becomes a Star Cop or they go their separate ways.
And instead, she just gets brutally murdered. This one again, though, it featured a sort of a space shuttle freighter thing that had been knocked off course as part of this espionage plot. But there was all the sort of attempts at space physics to get this thing back. And this was the episode, really, where it became apparent that the series itself, I think one of the problems with it is that it doesn't really pull very strongly in any direction. It's not really investigative police. It's not really science fiction. I think this was the point where I realised it's a very niche audience that are going to want this. And that if you're not entirely focused in on just enjoying it as a series, because most people will be tuning in for either cop drama or science fiction. And if you were tuning in for either one of those things, you're going to be brutally disappointed.
Are you, though?
Well, they're both in there, but they're not particularly strong flavours. The science fiction element isn't particularly strong. And the space detective cops thing isn't particularly strong. It's really just a band of people in space that are investigating crimes in a very ad hoc way. They're not a rigidly ruled space police force with...
But that's the point. That's making it a more Wild West, Wild Frontier thing, which is a lot of the intention in the first place. It was supposed to be the corruption and turning the other cheek and pretending not to notice what was going on and a very sort of American storyline. So I don't think saying a cops and robbers, as would have been at the time on British television, so your sort of Juliet Bravos and things like that, it wasn't that in space and it was never intended to be that in space.
No, but anybody tuning in for the star bit, anyone tuning in for the cops bit, they're not really that well defined. Take something like Blake 7 or, skipping forward 20 years, Firefly. Both of those got that Wild West in space thing quite well. That was really well defined. This, less so. Some of that might be because, as you pointed out earlier, perhaps the acting's not 100% A-grade.
Oh, God, not just the regulars. There are some truly dreadful guest slots. But the final episode, that space traffic controller blonde ranty woman, was unbelievably awful.
Well, I don't plan to go through individual episodes in any particular depth because there's some interesting stories in there. I mean, there's one where there's a chemical plant in the Channel Tunnel under attack. But it's all connected to some sort of research base on the moon.
With corridors straight out of the Ark in space.
Yes. Again, there are elements of Doctor Who in there, but it leads more towards Red Dwarf. But what are we on? Episode 4, that was all to do with Disappearance of a Scientist, with a salvage ship in it. Episode 6 was about drug trafficking. Now, episode 5 was really quite dark. This is where you've got the concept of not being able to spend too long in a zero-gravity environment or you will get ill. So Nathan's forced to take shore leave on Earth. But through a bizarre series of events, he's framed for drug trafficking and ends up in Rome. No, not Rome. Venice. It's a credit to the BBC that on a shoestring they recreated Venice. But that all became a drugs trafficking script. That was really quite dark.
Pretty much all of the Earth-based stuff was very dark.
It was, but every episode went in a completely different direction. I can't really see any faults with what they were trying to do story-wise with this thing. In episode 6, in Warm Blood, that was one where a returning survey ship is found and the crew are all instantly dead. They've all died at the same moment with no visible signs of death. And it all turns out that it's due to some drug that they're taking to keep the red blood cells healthy every month. Tying into the physics of what it would be like in space. Now, I suspect there have been some liberties taken, but at least it's trying to nod or kiss to the physics of space and how that would affect the story.
That wasn't really the point of those drugs.
No, it wasn't. It was just a complete side effect.
The point about the iron pills is that it's something they would be guaranteed to take, so they were being given experimental drugs hidden in the iron pills because they were an isolated community. So it's nothing to do with the physiology of red blood cells in space. It's to do with the fact that they were being illegally experimented upon. And the iron pills were an excuse for that to happen.
No, but what I mean is the iron pills and the red blood cells, that was the whole thrust of why they were taking the pills in the first place. But I like the fact that they'd at least dropped in that red blood cells would deteriorate in prolonged exposure to a zero-gravity environment. Episode 7, A Double Life, we venture into the world of cloning.
Yeah, that was a bit shit.
Did you? I quite like that one.
You like Sherlock Holmes, and it's a classic Sherlock Holmes thing.
Well, it was blindingly obvious from about 10 minutes in, possibly less than that.
Yes, every Holmes plot in Sherlock is blindingly obvious from about 3 seconds in, but you still enjoy it.
I find Sherlock witty. I don't find it particularly clever, but I find it witty and an enjoyable.
Yeah, but Sherlock Holmes should be clever.
I agree.
This has always been my argument, and it's why Sherlock is terrible, because it's not clever. Lots and lots and lots of shows can be witty, Sherlock Holmes should be clever. Sherlock isn't. We're not talking about Sherlock. Let's move on.
Oh, please, Les.
Until we do Sherlock.
God damn.
In which case.
He's off. Put your tin hat on. Episode 7's title was A Double Life. You kind of gave away the plot there, kids. Anyway.
Yeah, but as you say, the plot was pretty obvious from fairly early on.
Not a bad guest cast, though. Brian Guaspari, oh, I was convinced I'd seen in something else. And I looked him up on IMDb, and it turns out he's just been the regular guest actor in the 80s.
So just turns up in a mountain of stuff.
Yeah, but I have seen him in many things, but I don't remember him.
Many things.
Anitza Saul as Lady Asadi, who I thought was very, very striking and played a great character. And then I realised she was in Warriors of the Deep.
Oh, God, was that her?
That was her, can you believe?
I knew I'd seen her in something. I hadn't. God, she's had acting lessons in between, hasn't she?
And somebody had learned how to design and style her better to show off how beautiful she was. But Warriors of the Deep, well, how can we make our guest cast as ugly as possible? Episode 8 was Other People's Secrets.
Which we've done extensively on another episode, so...
And then we round off with Episode 9, Little Green Men and Other Martians.
Yeah, which was a double-length episode crammed down into one, so... Blink and you miss important bits of the plot. They'll just ignore important bits of the plot because they can't be bothered to extend on them. It was the final episode, and I thought it was by far the worst episode.
Yeah, it wasn't amazing. Roy Holder was in this as Daniel Larwood, the investigative journalist, and all the way through I thought he had an element of the Paul Jones about him. And also, which I didn't realise, Bridget Lynch Bloss, she was in it as the co-pilot. Who gets blown up, and she was Natasha in Revelation of the Daleks, who
also gets blown up. Oh, was she?
Yeah.
I mean, you can't tell anything of her at all because she's behind a visor for about a minute before she's blown up, so.
Not a great way to end. It's all sort of hinted at the end of this one, and I suspect it was more by accident than design, that having done their bit on the moon, they all troll off to Mars and do their bit there. Yeah, it wasn't a great end.
The end of it seemed to me very much Nathan saying, I've had second thoughts about going to Mars, but somebody needs to go. Who's going to fall on the sword? Pick and choose who it's going to be, because it ain't going to be me. I don't think there was a bad episode until we got to the end. And I've never been impressed by the final episode.
I think that's largely, though, because it's not actually supposed to be the final episode.
No, it's because it's not actually very good.
Well, yes.
The cliched journalist was painfully cliched to the point where you kind of assume that he's some sort of undercover agent because he is so much a caricature. You start off with characters like that female policewoman who is helping to investigate his girlfriend's death, who turns out to be the British spy because they want to get onto an American spy satellite. And just how brilliantly she was written in and she was acted. And then you've got that journalist and played by Roy Holder. So played by a decent actor who could have put in a less bombastic 1950s characterization. And then the whole bit about we've got this elaborate con, but because you happen to have found out about it and I haven't yet done anything illegal, but I'm still going to try and blow you all up. It just didn't come across very well. And for that to be the final taste of it was a shame. But there were some nice variation in the stories. I did like the penultimate episode where it's the disaster movie one and people are trapped in different bits of the base doing things that are kind of against type. And a lot of cliched disaster movie stuff in that, but it was still very well done. You had Jeffrey Belden being, well, Jeffrey Belden, really.
Yeah, he was magnificent, though.
He's always magnificent, but he's always exactly the same flavour of magnificent. And some of the science thing, your blood clots when you hit 42 degrees C, and they were experimenting on a planetary survey of their employees without letting them know about it or asking consent. All of that was really nicely done. Anna Shoon was a bit of a wasted character. I suspect she would have come into her own given more time to develop. But, you know, she was introduced 5 episodes in, so she wasn't there for half of the series. But overall, what did you think?
Well, overall, I've got to say I loved it. You're looking at basically the more or less 9 hours of mid to late 80s science fiction drama. That is not a good marvellous sell to your to average. Me. Well, it is to me as well. But I very much watch this on my own. Dawn walked in on me watching one of them, and there were sort of looks of derision as to what shit are you watching this time, whereas I was in raptures watching the thing. So it's a very niche thing. I just don't think it was given the chance that it should have been given. I think that the production values were far lower than it deserved. I think that the scheduling was far worse than it deserved. Monday night at 8:30. Goodness me, what a graveyard slot that is. We've poked fun at the casting and the acting. It isn't that terrible. Yes, there are the odd.
Yes, it is.
It's not great, but it's no worse, really, than some of the other stuff that we've watched and really loved. To watch Nightmare of Eden, Horns of Nymon.
Yeah, but that's bad chewing the scenery acting, which, okay, Pal Kensit is. That's quite entertaining. But an awful lot of it is just terrible and fairly irredeemably terrible. So no, I don't think the acting gets, yes, you get away with this because it's entertaining. No, the acting was awful.
But I do think it's a terrible shame that this only had one series. I'm delighted that the Big Finish series has taken it and run with it. Well, we got more episodes on audio than we did on television, and they were all of a very, very good standard. There's a couple of audiobooks which I've got to be honest, I'm not really interested in. For all the narration I've done, I don't actually find straight audio readings of books very interesting. I'd rather have either enhanced audiobooks or full cast dramas.
Well, you know my feeling about this.
I do. If it's not in your voice, then it's not really something you want to listen to.
Do it as something full cast.
I agree.
Or an enhanced reading or something like that. But something to make it a bit more interesting than just Jack and Ori.
This is why I've always tended to do enhanced audiobooks rather than just audiobooks, because I just think they bring it to life.
Yes.
So wrapping it up,
I've really enjoyed it. It's just there's been other stuff to talk about, but that doesn't detract from how entertaining the episodes are, how much I enjoyed watching them again. And I've watched these any number of times because I had the DVD for ages. I remember watching them and making a point of watching them first time around. And I think it looks great. I think it looks of its time. And yes, it's not perfect. And for what they are, they look pretty good. I think our niche, who plough their way through all of our ranting, and God love them, but God alone
somehow
knows what you do.
Yes.
I think if you haven't seen this, then you're likely to like it. Fill your boots.
And as a final gravestone, the whole series was released by the darlings that were Network. So get out there, find this while you can, and watch it. I'm fairly sure that you won't watch one and then put it back on the shelf.
No. Or if you do, there's something wrong with you, frankly.
And on that note,
on that alienating our audience note.
Yes, thank you very much for listening, boys and girls. It has been our pleasure to watch. We hope it's been your pleasure to listen. We'll be back next time with something equally joyous.
Bye-bye.
The Exton Moss Experiment featured Simon Exton and Ken Moss. All featured soundtracks are the property of their respective producers, and no infringement of copyright is intended. Title music was performed by the BBC Symphony Orchestra, and the programme was produced by Maverick Productions. For more information, please visit maverickproductionsuk.blogspot.com or find us on social media.